Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger. In the last few videos, we've been talking about positive polynumbers, or we might just say polynumbers for short. And these are fundamental building blocks for algebra. And the way I want you to think about them is that they are extensions of ordinary numbers, or more sophisticated versions of numbers. If you look at the way we add to positive polynumbers, or the way we multiply them, if you just look at the top level, the zero degree terms, then you just have ordinary addition of numbers, or ordinary multiplication of numbers. So at the top level, at the degree zero, we are just getting ordinary arithmetic, and what happens below is some kind of sophisticated or more fancy arithmetic that's built up from it. Today, let's start off by talking about another operation, the idea of multiplying a polynumber by an ordinary number to give us another polynumber. So for example, here's a polynumber 2, 3, multiplied by the ordinary number 5, gives us the polynumber 10, 15. And the rule is simply that you take a polynumber, you multiply by m, a number, and you get the new polynumber, all whose entries are multiplied by m. So we're scaling the polynumber. And this operation has some obvious properties, that if you have two polynumbers, p and q, and you take m times p plus q, you get mp plus mq. If you have two numbers, m and n, and you multiply a polynumber p first by n and then by m, it's the same as multiplying p by the product mn. And if we have m times p times q, or p and q are both polynumbers, that's the same as mp times q, which is also the same as p times mq, but I didn't have room to write it. So this is a useful additional operation that involves not just polynumbers, but also numbers as well. And we should be careful to distinguish between polynumbers and ordinary numbers. Technically, they're different objects. This idea of scaling polynumbers gives us an alternate way of thinking about multiplying two polynumbers, which makes it very parallel to Hindu-Arabic multiplication. For example, if you're multiplying 2, 3 by 1, 0, 4, the result, which is over here, 2, 3, 8, 12, can also be obtained by taking this one and multiplying it first by 2, giving us 2, 0, 8, and then multiplying it by 0, 3, which has the effect of multiplying each of the entries by 3 and also shifting everything down 1. So we've got 2 times 1, 0, 4 plus 3 times the shifted down 1. Why is that the same as Hindu-Arabic multiplication? Well, suppose we wanted to multiply the numbers 401, this one read up, times this number 32. In ordinary multiplication, we would use this 2 and multiply by 401 to give us 802. And then we'd multiply by 3, 3, 0, 12, and shift everything over 1 because we're actually multiplying by something in the tens spot. And then we add the ones, the tens, the hundreds, the thousands. Now normally, there being 12 here is not allowed, we would ordinarily carry something over to the next spot. But in this setup, what we're going to do is just allow the entries of each position to be arbitrary natural numbers, not restricted from the zone 0 to 9. So that's essentially what we're doing when we're doing this kind of multiplication. We're just doing Hindu-Arabic multiplication, allowing arbitrary numbers in each of the slots. And as another example, you can check that, say, 3, 2, 5 times 1, 4, 0 is obtained by first multiplying this by 3, multiplying it by 2 and shifting down 1, multiplying this by 5 and shifting down 2. And then adding all the way across, like that. Here's a very easy example with a special polynumber 01. Just noting that its effect on another polynumber is simply to shift it down 1. This polynumber is the simplest polynumber which is not itself essentially a number, and it's going to play an important role as we carry on. Now let's talk about associativity of multiplication. So suppose we have three polynumbers P, Q, and R with entries PI, QI, and RI. The product PQ is another polynumber whose ith entry is given by this formula. The sum over all K's and L, positive numbers, of PK times QL, where K plus L sum to I. All right, so now suppose we have these three polynumbers. We multiply them all together in the order PQ and then R. Well, the ith entry of that is, according to this rule, the sum over all K and L, where K plus L equals I, of the kth entry of P times Q times the lth entry of R. Okay, now this, what's inside here itself, is going to be replaced by this thing right here. So it's the sum over all, say, N and M, summing to K of Pn times Qm. So this is a double summation, a little bit complicated. Okay. But when you stare at it, you really have these three numbers, N, M, and L, and they have the property that they add up to I. And we're really multiplying P sub N times Q sub M times R sub L over all such possibilities. And when we've written it this way, we see that it's now symmetric. It'll be the same as what we get when we expand this thing out, P times QR, ith component. That's essentially a sketch of the proof of why associativity works. And to give you a sense of what this formula means, let's have a look at a few examples. So here we're multiplying three polynumbers, 1, 2, times 2, 5, times 4, 3. And that formula that we had at the end of last slide tells us the way we do this is as follows. To find the zeroth entry of the result, we take the product of all the entries whose indices sum up to zero. And there's only one way of doing that. It's the 0 plus 0 plus 0 makes 0. So there's 1 times 2 times 4, we get 8. To get the first entry, we have to look at products of three things, one from here, one from here, one from here, so that the sum of the indices is 1. So that could be 0, 0, 1, or it could be 0, 1, 0, or it could be 1, 0, 0. And there are the three products that we have to add up correspondingly, giving us 42. The second degree term is obtained by taking products of three things so that the sum of the indices is now 2. So that can be obtained by taking 1 times 5 times 3. That's degree 0, that's degree 1, that's degree 1, so that has a total degree of 2 when we multiply. Or we could take 2 times 2 times 3, or we could take 4 times 2 times 5. We add those three possibilities up, we get 67. And finally, the degree 3 term, there's only one way of getting a degree 3 term, is to take the degree 1 term times the degree 1 term times the degree 1 term. And this product that we've just done corresponds to the usual kind of polynomial product, multiplying 1 plus 2x times 2 plus 5x times 4 plus 3x, and we're getting that polynomial there. And here's another example that you can check the details to make sure you understand how this procedure works. So now that we've got some familiarity with polynumbers, it's time for us to say now exactly what is a polynomial. We'll do that next time. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger, and thanks for listening.